Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to RPT season number 7, episode 76. It is Wednesday, August the 4th, the year of our Lord, 2021. I am your host, Chingo Bling, and we got producer Rob in the building.
What up, everyone?
We rocking that new Tia merch.
Hell yeah.
Tamal Intelligence Agency. All this stuff will be up on the website real, real soon. I've been busy having babies, you know. I've been multiplying. I'm trying to spread the seed. You know what I'm talking about? We got a country to save, Rob. We need soldiers, brother. We got to protect the nuclear family.
And we need strong people, not weak people.
That's right, man. Educate your kids, man. Brainwash them in a good way before the world tries to brainwash them. I got a lot of mouths to feed, and I am on tour. Freedom of Speech Tour. I'm headed to San Jose, California. Hopefully, beautiful Gavin Newsom with his beautiful hair will not get recalled, and he will not shut down the state. So I'll be in San Jose August 18th. Also, if anyone's listening from New Orleans, I'm going to be with Jonathan Copel. He's putting together a nice rally in New Orleans for freedom. So I'll be out there hanging out August 14th. But back to the tour. Denver, Colorado, August 27th through the 29th. El Paso, Texas, September 9th through the 11th. Brea, California, September 15th. Oxnard, Califas, September 16th. Addison, Texas, I'll be at the Improv, October 7th through the 10th. San Antonio, Texas, October 14th through the 16th. Irvine, California, November 3rd. And then finally, Houston, Texas, November 5th through the 7th. It is a Freedom of Speech tour. Very, very important. Sass. We got to protect that speech, brother.
We do, absolutely. And if you guys want to join the next Zoom cast that we're going to be doing, that's just what we called it, right? Just
it's what it is. I like that, man. Yeah. Man, see, man, next to Trump, you're probably the king of branding.
Hey, man, you know I'm trying right now.
That's coming from me.
That actually means a lot. Jingle Bling, he started branding when before there was even an internet. So how the fuck do you do that?
Right? Damn, man, I'm old as fuck.
That's true, though. Talking about street teams and shit. Like, what? What the street team? Yeah, what are you talking about?
Bitch, I had a street team. I was mailing flyers.
Yeah, what were you slinging? Tamales and what else?
Dude, I was mailing flyers. Like, if you were on my street team, I'd mail you a box of flyers. It wasn't just a post. It wasn't an upload.
You would mail the street team
like, say you had, like, a kid in Fresno, a kid in Oregon, like, a kid, like, in Chicago that was, like, down, and they wanted to spread the word. You'd mail them some posters, mail them a t-shirt, a CD, and put some flyers in there.
Man, I wonder how many people are still doing that these days. Probably not enough.
Yeah, I don't know.
If you want to join us on the next Zoomcast, we had probably about 20 TIA members. We did it middle of the day. We're going to try to plan August a little bit better with more notice, maybe at a later time of the day where we can actually pop that Modelo or whatever it is you drink and kind of have a good time and talk about some serious subjects, but keep it light, keep it fun, all inside of the Patreon.
Yeah, it was great. It was great. You know, just to reiterate what Rob said, this was exclusive for some patrons. I got to see their face. They got to chime in. You know, they were talking. They can go... So. To go back and listen to it, you have to be a patron? Yeah.
Yes. There's a 20-minute teaser of that episode, like every other episode, on the iTunes, but it's only the first 20 minutes you and I did an intro. Zoomcast is only on Patreon if you're a member.
I learned a lot, man. One young lady, I believe she was from Dallas, she said that she tuned out from Chingo Bling when I started going too hard on the They Can't Deport Us All. I was going too hard for the immigrants, and she was like, she had an experience where...
Oh, with her children,
right? Her kid, she was trying to get her kid in preschool, and she did everything she was supposed to do. She was playing by the rules. She did the waiting list. She did the whole shebang. Come to find out, they were like, oh, your child isn't priority because your child is a citizen.
How crazy is that?
What the fuck? Come on, man.
Where is it at?
Come on, man. That is so crazy to me.
And shout out, I think that was either Amy or Rosa.
Yeah, I think her name was Amy.
Okay.
Another gentleman who caught the vid, he was still on an oxygen thing.
Yeah, he was on the Zoomcast.
Yeah, he called it Calirado. He said that's where he's from. So he had the tube thing and he was working and that was terrible. He said he had some scarring on his lungs, but he chimed in about...
A lot
of the leftists.
Highway?
I know, a big old thing of spit. A lot of the leftists that moved to Colorado, and they're just like California in his state.
Yeah, he's trying to get out of there, man. Every day I get people inside my personal DMs at RobGTV, if you want to follow, who are just trying to bounce California. Tons every day.
Yeah, so. I mean, as it is, bro, as it is, the entire country, you know, taxes about to go up, cost of goods going up. They're screwing us at the gas pump. It's very unfortunate. They're trying to literally crush the U.S. dollar. Meanwhile, you got the southern border wide open. So all these folks, you know, I don't knock them because I don't blame them for wanting to show up because they're putting the red carpet out.
Yeah.
They're being invited. So all these folks are about to enter the labor force in the middle of hyperinflation. You know, Wall Street's loving it because they love some cheap labor. They want a slave class. The Democrats love it because they want those voters. That's why they're not letting the Cubans in. So all the while, they're about to put the squeeze on the working class, the blue collar folk, you know, black folk, brown folk, poor white folk.
Yeah. Makes me think sometimes what the, you know, Uber driver, taxi driver, the people you've had these conversations with in the past in other cities or states or even countries. What, mm-hmm. I wonder what's going, like what they're going through right now. Just, you know, they're trying to spit them game at you. And then now let's fast forward 6 months. Like, what's their life like?
Yeah, because especially the migrant crisis is global. It's global because when America puts out the message, like the bat light of saying, come to America, you're not going to get sent back. You're not going to get deported. Just come through. Well, yeah, that's going to disrupt everything.
Yeah.
Like now people from Ghana, people from Haiti, people from all over are trying to find traffickers to help them get through Costa Rica. Who do I know in Nicaragua? You know what I mean? Like, who's going to usher me in through all these countries so that you can efficiently make it to Del Rio, Texas, or Mission, or McAllen? I just saw something that McAllen, it's like 7,000 migrants got dumped off downtown McAllen. They're having to set up these temporary camps now. Let me find it real quick.
Yeah, here's a video from shout out Oscar. Shot me a DM. He said, Rob, my cousin down in La Jolla just sent me this video of immigrants crossing. I don't have the followers that you guys do, but figured you can talk about it on the podcast. Do what you got to do with it. And it's just, you know, just a big ass group of people just in the middle of the night.
Hundreds, bro. Hundreds and hundreds. And it's not slowing down. It's only getting worse.
Yeah.
It's only getting worse. And we were watching CNN this morning from the hospital, and not a peep.
Yeah.
And they weren't going to talk about that. Here's something that Myra R143 out of McAllen, she posted. The city of McAllen is putting up tents in an empty lot near the intersection of North 23rd Street and Buddy Owens Boulevard. The tents will temporarily house migrants released by Border Patrol. So now they're spending more of the city taxpayer money on the border crisis, which Biden created. Since 2014, city of McAllen residents have dished out more than $2 million to pay for this, and not a peep from the city leaders. No one has the balls to stand up for the residents.
So he follows up with, my cousin's, so the cousin took this video, is a lib and not down with Biden at all and his bullshit, but she wanted to see the border for herself. So I said, which is around the block from where they live. And I said, what does she think about it all now? Nothing, not much, other than, you know, basically Biden should be getting crucified the way Trump did during his presidency for what's going on. And it's not out of the ordinary for immigrants to show up knocking at my grandma's house asking for food. She's been lucky thus far that nothing's happened to her.
Oh, bro, before I forget. So we just had a baby. We were in the hospital.
You can hear about it all on Chingo Chats.
Yeah, go tune in on that. So while we were in the hospital, Marisol had already signed up to Fox Nation. Have you heard of that?
Yeah, their app.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You heard of that? Okay. So I got a love-hate relationship with Fox News, right?
I think we all do.
Yeah, because they're owned by the Murdochs. They're not covering Mike Lindell's cyber symposium. They decided to not run the ads that Mike Lindell's trying to run. They're not covering the elections or the
audits.
Forensic audits. Yeah. So love-hate. They're owned by the Murdochs. It is what it is. Anyway, so Tucker Carlson is doing the Lord's work over there. He did a few docuseries, bro. I don't know if you've seen them, but if you go on Fox Nation, the app, and stream some of these episodes, they're really, really well done. They're like documentaries. They have one that's all about MS-13. So they're like showing, like, the prison's full. This is when Tucker went down to interview the president of El Salvador, who fucking tightened shit up. Bro, when that new little president, the little Lebanese cat, whatever he is, from El Salvador, when he got into office, crime went down, murder rates went down, because you got 18th Street Gang, MS-13. They're just basically extorting the citizens and small business owners. They don't just kill you, they overkill you. Mm-hmm. Like, they stab the shit out of you. Some of them are little devil worshipers and stuff. And a lot of hits were being called from within the prison in El Salvador. So somebody might get killed in Cali, in California. It was all from a phone call in El Salvador within the prison. So first thing he did, he said, all right, bet. He called the, I guess, all the telecommunication companies and said, hey, I don't want to see no activity from these prisons. Shut it down. Boom. So now these people, oh, here's another thing he did. He was the first one to mix the prisons up where you got both rivals. You got MS-13 and 18th Street in there together. Para que se den en la madre. Para que se maten a la fregada. And I don't know if they had a truce. I don't know how much violence there was. But basically, there's no TV, no phone, no nothing. Strict lockdown. All y'all in the same cell. Ain't shit for you to do. Like, it's rough. But anyway, he has several docuseries. He did one all about the border. So he's in Uvalde, Texas. Hmm. He's down there talking to landowners, ranchers. And
Tucker himself?
Yeah, Tucker's down there with his production crew. And they'll meet with the sheriff. And the sheriff is like, we're going to go over here. We got to go check these trains because these trains pass through here. And there's always migrants in there. So they're like, okay, train just showed up. Boom, they catching people. There's high-speed chases. They went to kick it with some ranchers, some people that have some land, and they got a house and, you know, a little backyard. And they have kids and stuff, and they're riding around on the little, like, gator, the little golf cart mm-hmm. type thing. And they're just showing, like, damage on their property, people trying to sleep on their property, like, breaking shit, polluting, littering, showing them their ring camera of them trying to, like, break into the house. In the middle of them being out there, then people had to get their guns and go haul ass because it was some cartel motherfuckers, some crazy shit. But all these different episodes are like really well done. It's on Fox Nation, and you could just go on there and just click different ones.
I wonder what the relationship is with Fox and somebody like a Tucker Carlson, who I think has the biggest news show in the entire country.
That's why he's under attack. That's why they're spying on him.
Yeah, that's true.
That's how you know you're above the target. You start catching all that heat. I mean, think about how the left has treated me.
Yeah.
You know, the party, what is it? The party of the tolerance or whatever. Mm. I mean, we're catching heat. You know, if you're over there with the George Lopez's of the world, ain't nobody really fucking with you except for some of the patriots. They get on the comments, be like, bitch, you told us to vote for Biden.
Yeah.
This is, own it, bro. You were on there hosting Zoom calls with this man. You damn near, you don't want to press play on Despacito. You know what I mean? Like, the Eva Longorias of the world, not a peep. So, but anybody that leaves the Democrat plantation, boy, you start catching them lashings.
Yep.
They coming after you, and that's how you know you're above the target.
And I'm not seeing anybody talk about any of these, because you're seeing more and more articles or videos come out about how, what are we calling her? Kamala is like the most unliked vice president in the history of vice presidents. You know, she couldn't oh get a fucking percentage points of any kind of favor when she was running for president. And it's funny, dude, because like she called out Biden, you know, for the racism and the bills. She called out everybody on that, you know, DNC stage, and then Tulsi sank her ship, and then she dropped out, and then somehow here she is.
Yeah, she was single digit Kamala.
Yeah.
And somehow, some way, man, she got ushered in. I mean, I'm not a huge, you know, Bernie fan just because of all the socialism.
Yeah.
But arguably, he is a populist, you know, for the people or whatever. Yeah. And the DNC shafted him a couple times.
Twice, yeah, or three times.
A couple times.
Yeah.
So, I mean, goddamn. I mean, they screwed Trump over because I don't know if I'm allowed to say it, but, you know, if y'all look into those, what's the word, anomalies or whatever, like there's just some things that don't add up. Like in Wisconsin, I think Trump, y'all could go fact check me because I haven't slept. We just had a baby. But I think in Wisconsin, he lost by like 20,000 votes. Mm-hmm. However, they found like over 160,000 votes that were just like super illegitimate.
Yeah, that was something similar in Arizona, right? And is that Maricopa County?
Yeah.
And not only that, but that place isn't, you know, the county isn't playing ball with whatever they're asking for.
Yeah.
So
yeah, you got Biden's Department of Justice trying to put the kibosh on it. And then I saw on CNN this morning, they were talking about Georgia and all the, I guess, discrepancies with that election. And they're like, these are baseless. There's been zero evidence. And it's like, bro, come on now. Y'all know damn well Georgia was more of a cesspool than Arizona.
And meanwhile, California's recall election is going to be mail-in ballots.
Yeah.
Because of the Delta. Because
of Delta. So these motherfuckers, man, they're using every letter in the Greek alphabet to get what they want accomplished. If they want to lock you down, if they want to crush small business, if they want to usher in vaccine passports, if they want to ban you from gyms and indoor dining or whatever based on vax status, they just using the Delta, and if that shit don't work, they gonna hit you with the Lambda. And if that shit don't work, the Iota and the Phi and the Kappa, wait till that Kappa come through.
When I was driving over here, I was thinking to myself, man, it's funny the people that I saw post like on election or even, you know, inauguration day, the captions were pretty similar, just from random people. All right, you know, let's everybody brace yourself for this totalitarian, you know, fascism, socialist, you know, communist world that's coming, sarcastically, as if like, you know, I can't believe people were, you know, thinking that's what's going to happen.
Oh, leftists saying
that? Yeah. Now it's like, I wonder what they think about what's going on.
Maybe they still don't see it.
For sure they don't.
Yeah.
For sure they don't.
I mean, the only shit is just a few patriots standing in their way, bro. The people that's like, hey, we still got the Constitution. You know, you still can't run amok and strip us of all of our freedoms. But con cada pinche letra del virus, like every chance they get, they're just, what's the word, man? Chipping away.
Yeah.
Chipping away at the Constitution, chipping away at the freedoms. And it's like, if y'all only knew what some other countries, you know, have gone through, are going through.
Are going through, yeah.
Are going through. I mean, all these little communist sympathizers, take your ass to Venezuela. You like some damn communism so bad. Take your ass to Cuba. Go to North Korea. Go to North Korea. You like it so much.
PragerU has a really good Che Guevara video right now. Have you seen it?
No.
Yeah, I mean, people have made tons of them, and PragerU's done a few of them. But the little animation, you know, it's really simple animation, but it gets the point across because they have such good storytellers on there. But it was great, man. And it's like, I wish everybody that wears a Che shirt or has a flag would watch that and then have a real conversation about it.
Yeah, I may have been guilty of that. I don't know. Maybe when I was like young in college.
Yeah, but if you don't know, you don't know.
You know, yeah, because you just see it at the mall and you're like, well, shit, Jay-Z wore it.
Hot Topic or some shit.
Yeah, Target. And now that I think about it, oh my God. It's like, first of all, Jay-Z, how dare you wear that? Like, if you don't know what that is, if I'm not mistaken, I was like in Miami kicking it with a Pitbull and some of his people a long time ago, and they're all damn near mostly Cuban American.
Yeah.
And I think I remember hearing them say something like, yo, this motherfucker Jay-Z wore that stupid ass shit. And I'm like, it looks like a cool design to me. Like the dude's face is on there. And I'm just like, huh? Like, I think even at that point, I think I might have owned a shirt like that, or I didn't know or whatever. And they're like, bro, that's communism. And even then, I'm just like, I don't know what the fuck that is. And they're like, bro, that's what our people escaped. Like, that's why our people have no freedom. And that's why they would call a Cuba Libre, the drink, a mentirita, meaning Cuba ain't libre. So now, knowing what I know, it's like, Target better not have no shit like that.
Yeah.
Like, do not promote any of this Marxist crap. You know, it's terrible. It just leads to communism.
Yeah, and it leads to people who are, you know, easily susceptible to things like that, rhetoric like that, narratives like that, to just fall for it, hook, line, and sinker, because you don't know no better.
Because they package it real nice. Like, well, it's about equality. Yeah, in Cuba, people equally starving. And they equally ain't got no rights.
Have we mentioned the TIA merch, by the way? Chingo's got a lot of mouths to feed.
No, I'm talking about, I got mouths to feed, baby. Brand new TIA merch.
Yeah, this is my favorite hat.
Shout out to the patrons. Patreon.com/RedPillTamales.
Yeah.
So where do we start today, man? I know we're kind of just easing into it. I like the conversational kind of thing because there's just a lot to have conversations about, right?
Oh, man.
So besides the topics and the actual news that's going on out there, I think as listeners come to the podcast, they appreciate you just kind of pontificating about what's going on from somebody who understands like what you just explained, right? A story from probably 15, 20 years ago where you just were oblivious to it. And now that you're not oblivious to it, it makes a lot of sense.
Whoa.
Yeah.
You're playing with fire.
Yeah. And like, you're putting the two situations together and expressing that in a way that people should be able to get.
Yeah. It's dangerous ideology. Very dangerous. Marxism in the past has been used to divide people based off class. Like they sell you this idea that like, hey man, the rich people got to pay their part, which they should, right? But they sell it to you in a way where it's like, before you know it, then you have any struggle sessions. You know what I mean? Where you're just like selling out your mom. Like, I think my mom is a capitalist and you know, she's against the community. And here we are, they're teaching critical race theory. they're teaching that, you know, all white people bad, they're responsible for every atrocity, and all black people, brown people are victims. And, you know, it's not enough to be not racist. You have to be anti-racist.
Yeah, stupid shit like that.
Mamones.
So I hope you finish the Yummy Park North Korean defector between now and either tomorrow or the day after when we record the premium episode of RPT, so that we can talk more about how something like that, you know, could happen here. But then also just maybe your takeaways from it, because I mentioned the Chingo chat. I've always had, you know, a heart for everybody, no matter what. But when it's so just stupid, I'm gonna tell you it's stupid.
What's stupid? What
any little you know, crying wolf for any little thing that's just completely nonsensical and unreasonable. Because a lot of this stuff is just unreasonable.
So basically, I think what Rob is trying to say is that when you go listen to Yeonmi Park on Joe Rogan, she was from North Korea and she escaped. When you hear about the atrocities of communism, the dangers of Marxism, and what this young lady had to endure and witness, it just makes everything else, like all kind of little first world problems. Mm-hmm. Like, you over here got fat on your body and you complaining about some shit. There's people literally being starved to death.
Yeah, so when you talk
graphic.
About oppression, yeah, really graphic. When you talk about oppression, you know, she went through real oppression. So when she's like, when I hear people talk about, you know, you're oppressed because you're white or black or something or brown, that's not real oppression, you know? Yeah. Like, let me tell you what's really... So it's just like, again, you still have, you know, a heart for people here in the States, but when it's just unreasonable, I'm going to call you. I have no desire to what do you call it? Just like...
Sugarcoat,
whatever adjective you want to use. It's just so dumb. A lot of it's so dumb. A lot of it's just bad ideas that are getting spouted by people with platforms, you know, people with audiences. Makes it that much harder for people like us to have a reasonable conversation about it.
It, when you hear what Yeonmi Park went through, it makes you appreciate, dude, by the grace of God, I was born in America.
Right?
Oh my God. It just, like, I damn near want to cry right now. However, I mean, our freedoms are being stripped away little by little, but we're still the shit.
Yeah.
Like, don't get it twisted. Like, you cannot do what we're able to do in America. You cannot do it anywhere else. Like, try it. You know what I'm saying? Go to Mexico. The peso ain't shit compared to the dollar. Even though right now they're trying to crush the U.S. dollar. Right now, the U.S. dollar is still the standard. Right, we're able to print up money out of thin air and get by as they're trying to figure out how they're going to back all that spending. Like, I guess we're going to tax people more. They're trying to figure out they're going to sell more government bonds to other countries, but they don't want any more because they already bought all the ones they wanted. So inflation is through the roof. But even still, this is still America, even with all the fucking bullshit propaganda and all the dumb woke crap. And I mean, division is at an all-time high. Our elections are not as credible as you would like them to be. But this is still America. And people got to stand up, man. Like, don't fall for the okey-doke, and don't let them Cuomo you to death. You know, don't let them de Blasio you to death. Don't let them Newsom you to death, where they're just like, Delta's very scary. Don't worry that our southern border is wide open and we importing the Delta. Delta's very scary. Therefore, fuck your rights.
Yeah, and that goes into some of the topics today. But before we get into those, we haven't mentioned the housing moratorium.
The eviction crisis.
The eviction crisis that's coming, because it ran out July 31st, and now Joe B. Biden is trying to, you know, put something together to keep pushing that off, I guess. So to the best of my knowledge, states have money, have funds, but they've been having a hard time putting together a system to get them to the people that need it, right? But it only counts or goes toward things that happen, I think, if it was the CARES Act or whatever it was back in September, when this started under Trump, that people will get their rent, I guess, or the landlords will get their money for the rent that they're owed. But it's still going on. It's August 4th, rather, and this ran out the 31st. So what's going to happen? Who's going to end up on the streets? What landlords are going to be stuck holding the bills? And, you know, all this shit's still coming up on top of the things you mentioned, the inflation and the skyrocketing gas prices.
So some of our renters called and they're like, hey, we caught COVID and we got fired because of it. So I know it's the first. So what can you do?
Damn.
And Marisol's in a hospital bed like, can you pay half? You know what I'm saying? Because shit, we gonna be stuck with the bill.
Right.
So, está cabrón. But yes, I definitely want to go finish listening to that Rogan episode.
Yes.
Bless her heart, Yeonmi Park, for spreading the word of America equals freedom. Don't let them take that away, you know, because your kids are going to grow up in a world where they're not going to know what freedom is like. They're not going to miss it because they won't know what it is. So for every woke person spewing that crap rhetoric, like those soccer players kneeling and what's it, Logan Park? What's his name? Logan Paul?
Yeah, Logan Paul.
Logan Paul shouting his little struggle session. Hopefully, a lot of people can go listen to Yeonmi Park's episode and realize, okay, this is really scary to be seeing people literally just dead bodies every day, you know, totalitarianism, only one channel, state-funded, curated media propaganda, all power to the government, big, big government, no liberties. Very, very scary.
So this clip's kind of long, but I kind of wanted to segue into something else. But this is from CBS. You know, Biden's talking about the moratorium and whether it's going to hold up constitutionally, right? Mm-hmm. What they're trying to do. So, you know, check it out if you haven't heard him talk about it. It's just, he sounds so like out of it. Like, actually, let's play a little bit of
here
it.
Here he is quick. Listening to his earpiece.
He sounds just like defeated.
About to announce a new partial eviction moratorium, COVID related. Can you tell us any more about that? And are you sure it's going to pass Supreme Court muster?
The answer is twofold. One, I've sought out constitutional scholars to determine what is the best possibility that would come from executive action or the CDC's judgment. What could they do that was most likely to pass muster constitutionally? The bulk of the constitutional scholarship says that it's not likely to pass constitutional muster.
So it's super long. He talks super slow, but it's just like, it's just circles, you know? It's just like diarrhea of the mouth shit that doesn't make... I mean, I'm sure the reporters a lot of times are like, what? That didn't answer my question at all. So then, you know, I read this, or I listen to this and I read it, and this guy's right here is the first reply that I see. Can you read that for the listeners?
Okay, Joel Wendland Liu says, some capitalist landlord and another will be out there fighting to throw people out onto the streets.
And that's how a lot of people see what's happening, right? Not keeping... And then I think there was another good reply to it. Right under it.
Someone said, this may be unconstitutional, but it's an American right to fuck over those working in favor of those who think they shouldn't have to work.
Why was it? Man, there was another one where... actually, you know what? I'm going to pull it up because it was... Someone else replied to that guy, I think. But either way, I wanted to just highlight, this is the kind of people that are, you know, having these conversations on Twitter and talking about subjects like this. Look at the guy's profile. Look at his...
Joel Wendland Liu. How about got 189 followers? He said, what do you want
his
me to read?
Bio. Look at his...
Survivor of January 6th terrorism. Okay, this has to be a bot.
That's what I'm saying.
Shut the fuck up.
You know how many people are out there? They're just, or not people, but like accounts rather, that are spewing this shit. He looks like a made up fucking Photoshop character.
They just grabbed a photo somewhere.
Yeah.
It's hard to find out who's a real person and who ain't.
And it's all just like, you know, Nancy Pelosi tweets, and it's just all the, look at this. He's got no followers, obviously, but it's just how many of these fake ass accounts are out there spewing the stuff.
How many fake ass accounts have I argued with back and forth? With some dude in Indonesia that has like 20 cell phones taped to a wall.
It's so dumb, man. It's so dumb. So, but anyway, somebody else.
But I will say this.
Yeah.
This moratorium, I don't fully comprehend all the nuance of it. I saw a clip where Tim Pool was trying to warn people about, like, you know, the bubble and everything that might be coming and what all ramifications could be. But shit, I could barely spell moratorium.
That's so dumb.
I know somebody's going to grab that part and be like, see, he doesn't know anything about anything. He can't even spell moratorium. He just told you himself.
Oh, you know what? I actually pulled a little Politico article here that might give a little bit of a brief description. Hey, read this. This is sad as fuck right here under the picture.
Oh, wow. Here's a photo caption. Chelsea Rivera, 27, stands outside Franklin County Evictions Court in Columbus, Ohio. The single mom is behind $2,900 in rent and late fees for the one-bedroom apartment she rented for herself and her three young sons. So I think the critique I've heard is that a lot of folks were getting that government money and they weren't paying their rent because they're because they were like, shit, I'm getting money from the government and I've got this moratorium where I have to pay my rent and I'm going to go buy Jordans.
Here, read the, if you're short in time, these are kind of three bullet points I think will help people.
All right, here we go. A CDC ordered eviction moratorium expired July 31st and top Democrats are at odds about how to revive it. About 3.6 million people face eviction within 2 months, and about 6 million households are behind on their rent. Estimates of the back rent owed are in the tens of billions of dollars. Here comes BlackRock?
Yeah.
BlackRock gonna come in and buy it all up.
Swoop.
About $42 billion in aid remains unspent as many states struggled to set up rental assistance programs. So this is kind of what you were saying, which is there's money that the states have where they haven't figured out the best system to get it to the landlords to cover for the folks that probably couldn't go to work.
Yeah, couldn't go to work, weren't getting enough money or whatever. But again, that I think is going to cover September to last month, essentially. And then what? Because they're still not, you know, able to pay the rent.
It's almost like this is a symptom of lockdowns.
Yeah, one of many unfortunate symptoms.
Ain't that a bitch?
But you know what? More's coming. So what do you want to do about it?
Man, I'm telling y'all, man, some of this stuff is just like by design. It's just by design.
It just seems that way, doesn't it?
It's just on purpose. It's like, how do we destabilize a country? How do we destabilize a superpower? Let's get one of their political powers. I mean, one of their political parties. Let's just say, pretend I'm China. And I want to be real cool with the Democrats. Hey, here's what I need y'all to do. I need y'all to listen to everything the CDC going to say and just follow the playbook. Whatever Swalwell... Whatever we told our spies to tell Swalwell to do, do that. It just seems like Pelosi and some of these people are in their pocket. And these politicians seem like they've been bought and paid for. And here we are. Somebody stuck holding the bill.
Yeah. And then, you know, it sounds weird saying that out loud. Like what you just said, like how else, you know, do you crumble a superpower? Or it's weird that we're having these kind of conversations, but by design, it looks like by design is what's happening. And it looks like a lot of people are falling for it, don't want to see it, are ignoring the fact that it's real. And it makes you wonder, like, how many of those people are NPCs? This is where we put our tinfoil hats on. How many of these people are just completely batshit, lost their mind, mental, and just can't see it or refuse to see it because they've been compromised somehow?
Yeah. It's like, if you're, let's just pretend you're China.
Yeah.
Before you get to a kinetic war, right? Before wars get, you know, physical.
Yeah.
Where you got to have, you know, some ships in, you know, South China Sea or something. You're probably going to want to crush the U.S. dollar.
Sure.
You probably want some critical race theory in their military. You probably want to brainwash their future generation, their kids, make them hate their country and hate each other. You know, hence critical race theory. You know, maybe... erode their borders, fuck over their sovereignty, keep some open borders going on, maybe own some of their media and newspapers, own some of their politicians. And if you can tamper with their elections, even better. You know, maybe they'll use these dumb onion machines. Maybe you can hack those, maybe hack their infrastructure, maybe hack their pipelines. You know, maybe put a leader in there that's going to do the opposite of what should be done. And all the while, make somebody like Trump look bad.
Yeah.
And there you go. There you have it.
Yunmi Park made Rogan asked her about Trump. And she's like, the one good thing that he did do, for sure, without a doubt, is calling out China. He said he's the first president in history to call out China and the CCP and what they're doing and how the United States has to do something about it. And meanwhile, so many people in the country were just like, no.
Oh, man, we got to make a... Can you make a clip out of that?
Yeah.
You can?
Yeah.
Because...
I'll screen record it and make a clip out of it.
Well, I've tried that because when Jay Prince was on Joe Rogan, I tried doing a screen grab and I don't know how Spotify worked around it.
Mm.
It wouldn't let me.
Interesting.
Mm.
I did one with somebody and it let me do it, but maybe they changed the...
Dude, if you can grab that little part, that'd be dope.
Okay, I'll try to grab that for sure. Easy with your Delta variant over there.
Meanwhile, right? I know, right? Meanwhile, I'm going to try to figure out if I'm part Korean.
Why? Because your baby looks like Yunmi?
Well, yeah, that too. But my cousin in Mexico, dude, she told me this crazy story, bro.
About what?
Okay. When I went down there to do some shows in Mexico, right? This experiment called Comedy in Español. And my cousin that I hadn't seen since we were little kids, we were drinking. So I took it with a big grain of salt. But she's like, you know, we got some Korean blood in us. And I'm like, what? She said, yeah. And she started breaking it down. She's like, look, it's actually like a really cool love story because it sounds like a movie. She says, it's on my dad's side for sure, not my mom's side. So she says something like, yeah, our grandparents' grandparents or something like that, they were both from Korea. They moved to Mazatlan, probably to escape the first Kim, when all the fucking communism kicked in, maybe. I don't know. That's now I'm trying to put the pieces together. Supposedly, they moved to, was it Mazatlan? No, that sounds like that beach in Sinaloa. It was like, not Mazatlan. Somebody's like yelling at their phone.
Yeah, for sure.
Well, I can't remember, but they moved to some part of Mexico, met in Mexico, and it's like, where are you from? Where are you from? Oh, snap. My parents are from there. Oh, snap. We came here too. Oh, snap. Let's fall in love type of thing.
What?
But I asked my dad about it. He didn't know anything about it. He's like, what? We ain't Korean? Meanwhile, he's looking Asian as fuck. So I'm going to try to get to the bottom of that because I just feel like I got some revolutionary something in me.
Have you... so I guess you're talking about maybe doing like a 23andMe or something like that?
I don't want China having my bio data.
Yeah, you're trying to give away your DNA like that?
Yeah,
so like
I don't
West
think...
World you later?
Yeah, I don't want them to clone me like that, bro.
They're going to clone you for sure.
Fuck.
Yeah. Either that or they're going to put you into a, you know, a robot. The singularity's coming.
They're going to download my brain into another hard drive.
I don't remember who it was, but somebody was talking about Zucks. Mr. Mark Zucks was giving a talk to someone or something, and he was mentioning how Facebook's working on this next generation of computing where it's going to open up, you know, this whole new metaverse or something that's like, kind of like the internet within the internet. It made it sound like the fucking Matrix, bottom line, right? So I was trying to wrap my brain around this short conversation that they were having about his, which I haven't seen it, but maybe it's worth pulling up later and sending to you and watching, because it's literally like the guy was talking about, they're working on creating the Matrix, you know, a world where it's more enjoyable and just better to be in than the actual physical world.
Like some, almost like virtual reality type of thing.
Like, like a VR.
Well, as they're trying to turn Americans into Russian serfs, where you will own nothing and be happy. What is it? The Party of Davos,
the World Economic Forum? Yeah.
Charles Schloss or whatever his name is. Charles Schloss.
Schwab?
No, not Schwab.
Klaus?
Yeah.
Klaus, yeah.
Ese puto. Him, World Economic Forum, the Party of Davos. They're trying to turn y'all into Russian serfs. That's why it's so hard for millennials to even buy a home and even have a piece of the American dream. They're making it hard, man. They squeezing us from every angle.
Sam Tripoli right now is like, yes, Shingo, tell him.
Oh, he talked about that?
He talked about that all the time.
Well, he's right on the money. That's not conspiracy at all.
You did Tinfoil Hat, right?
Yeah, it's going to be a premium episode, so that's going to be behind a paywall.
Sweet.
And I think he said he's going to send me the file if we want to put it behind our, like, for the Patreons.
Oh, badass.
Yeah, I think so.
Cool.
Yeah, it got a little controversial in some parts because he had to like backtrack some shit. Like, let me clarify what I was trying to say. But yeah, so what is this, man? Elizabeth Warren wants teen girls to think of abortion as a basic right. Teen girls. Doing abortions as a basic right.
So did I put in there who she gave this talk to? I didn't. Do you want to take a guess who she had this conversation with? It's a magazine. It's a sister of a big magazine publication.
Let me see. Teen People?
Close. Teen Vogue. Yeah. So I didn't know this, but Teen Vogue apparently in 2012, 13-ish, or no, 15, I think, went a lot more political. So a lot of their content, which is geared to teenage girls, is very political.
Make them leftist.
I mean, that's what it sounds like, you know? Yeah. I mean, I'm just reading what I'm seeing.
Pushing out abortion.
Can't believe everything you see on the internet, but it is what it seems like. The article itself, where was it? Didn't really have too much to say other than she wants, you know, young girls to get out there and be vocal. And, you know, if you can post about it, she even said, if you want to make a TikTok about it or you want to make videos about it, talk about your right to, you know, have an abortion. And if there's actual meetings or hearings that you can attend to in person, make sure you go out there and let your officials know how you feel about it. So that was interesting, considering a lot of Americans in big numbers, but on both sides, I think it was like in the 80s, are completely against it after the first trimester. So it's like, okay, I guess that's a different conversation. Like, the length of when you can have one is really kind of what we're talking about, right? I don't know. I figured it was appropriate because we just talked about you having a baby.
Man, it's crazy, bro. Like, this is a teen magazine, and she's talking about it like it should just be willy-nilly.
Yeah.
Basic right. Like, you should be out there twerking, pregnant, sipping Hennessy, popping a Plan B pill, you know, in the middle of some type of a riot. Let's see. Elizabeth Warren discussed the necessity of abortion rights in an interview with Teen Vogue. The Massachusetts senator equated abortion to the right to vote. She described them as, quote, protection of personal autonomy, and stated that, quote, this is where the two big fights are shaping up right now. Quote, the right-wing extremists know that if they can keep people from voting, they've got a better chance to impose their views about abortion on an unwilling nation, she said, referring to pro-life advocates as, quote, a small but intensely focused group of people who want to impose their will on the majority of this nation. Which is strange, because Joe Biden tries to brand himself as the most Catholic president in history, but yet he's pro-abortion.
I think that quote of hers is at the bottom here somewhere. Was this it?
We want to make...
speak up loud. Is that
it? Speak up loud in as many ways as you can. Do it through text and TikTok and Snapchat and Facebook, but also show up in person whenever you can. If there's a town hall or a meet and greet with your local officials, show up, raise your hand, and ask a question. Ask about the issue. Speaking of TikTok, American Airlines is, I think, doing a promotion where they give you 30 minutes of free TikTok in the air, where you can get on TikTok for 30 minutes.
What?
Huh. Convenient, right? Chinese-owned app.
Hey, man, we're trying to blow up and go viral on TikTok.
Yeah, I know. I'm not mad at their algorithm, though. They let me get a lot of views.
Yeah, no shit, right?
They let me get like 130,000 followers, like, in a little while. So with minimal effort.
What you need to do is all those reels that I'm posting on... download those, dude, and just go to town. Go to town. There'll be like 3 to 6 new pieces of content every day.
Yeah, you're killing it. I saw that shit. I was like, damn.
Yeah.
Rob's been editing.
Yeah. We're going to go to town on that shit. Meanwhile, you know, with one less podcast I have to do, you know, per week with Mighty Soul Down, we've already got hers all taken care of all month. Mm-hmm. I'm going to be every day just clipping.
And you know what, man? As I try to figure out, you know, because you talk to me all the time about, like, hey, man, think about what you're doing as a media company, you know, which I need those reminders. But I'm trying to figure out, okay, how are you going to go from a touring comedian to creating your stuff more like a media company? Mm-hmm. For example, like, how do you just beef everything up? You know, we got all this new equipment and stuff we got to install. I started this Theo Juve weekly mini episodes, so I already posted 2 episodes, and I already got the 3rd one edited for next week, and the 4th one already shot. So all these little things, it's like, how do we shift gears from, all right, man, you got to be moving tickets, you got to be getting on an airplane, like, how do you turn it into like a media empire, you know, because we look up to like Your Mom's House, or, you know, Rogan, Tim Pool,
yeah,
all these different people,
Crowder,
yeah, that found a way to. So the reason I'm talking about it, what brought,
I'm glad
that,
you bring it up, yeah.
Well, what brought it to mind is that, like you just finished saying, I'm gonna be shifting some energy towards content creation,
yeah,
meaning editing, chopping up in little mini bits as a reel or a TikTok, and it's like, how can I do the same? How can I shift some of my energy towards more content creation instead of just like, oh, I got a meme in my phone.
Sure.
And I'm gonna post at 3 o'clock or some shit. Instead, I want it to be like, oh shit, he posted like this rap video thing for Throwback Thursday, and he's got this Theo Juventino thing on Wednesday, and he went live on Monday.
Yeah.
And he did a Zoom with his patrons on Tuesday, and new podcast episode. That's how I want to kill it.
Yes, I'm glad you're talking about that too, and we'll shift gears into this conversation for a little bit, because I was thinking about that a lot over the weekend. And for you, it's like, you're a comedian first, honestly. You're a comedian first, you're an entertainer. So you have to be able to shift into that gear when you're on tour, when you're on the road. We have dates coming up. And not forget about the other content that we do back at home while you're on the road, but it has to be separate, you know, punto y aparte. You know, you're on the road doing comedy, and it's not even political comedy, which is great, I think.
Yeah, at all.
But it has to, we have to cross-pollinate and let those audiences know they're going out to shows, that are showing up, that are taking pictures, that are doing VIP, that, hey, also, you know, whether it's mentioning it after the show or mentioning it while you're doing VIPs, that we're doing all this other stuff on, we'll call it, for the sake of the story, the RPT network, right? Or mm-hmm. the CBTV network, mm-hmm. where you're getting your comedy, you're getting the you know, whatever we want to call it. It's more culture. It is political, but it's all cultural, right? It goes back to the culture's downstream of politics. Mm-hmm. If we keep it all cultural, kind of like Teen Vogue did. When you go to the Teen Vogue website, which I did just for the story that I read, they have it all, like Tim Pool has it on his new one. Culture is one of the highlighted links or tabs that you're going to click on, because it's like politics, COVID, and culture. Like, that's just what, you know, is going on around the world, and all of it feeds off of each other. And we're kind of doing it here. You're doing it with entertainment. We're doing it with the podcast. Mm-hmm. We're doing it with the content creation on, you know, Snapchat and TikTok. But yeah, it's got to be, and it has to be micro doses. You know, I know you put a lot of effort into, or we put a lot of effort into long form content, but mm-hmm. when we make the long form content, we then have to take the time to cut it all down.
Yeah, parse it down.
Yeah, man. Yeah. The attention spans of people are just so short mm-hmm. that everything that we do is basically just, it's lead generation, right? All these reels over the last 2 days have gotten more views than most of the actual good, beefy conversations that I put up with Ed, with Jorge Ventura, with even Jonathan Copel. Now I'm going to go back and I'm going to cut up all those into tiny 15-second, you know, or less clips, because it's going to grab that person's attention and want to go listen to the, ideally want to go and listen to the mm-hmm, full episode. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And that's just kind of the world we're living in. And it's not really getting any longer than that. I know TikTok just ramped it up to 3 minutes. You can post 3 minute TikToks. So what I was reading is that people are just speculating that TikTok wants to just know what people want more of. So is 3 minute TikToks here to stay, or is it just kind of like a temporary, like what are people actually staying mm-hmm. to watch more of, so that when they consume the majority of these short clips, they're going to continue to scroll on this person's profile.
And it sucks that it's, you know, a Chinese owned app, which the way it works with the CCP is I think it's called Article 7, like in their
charter.
Yeah, whatever it is, where basically they're able to summon whatever they want from whatever company within their country. So it kind of sucks that it's like, but ni modo, all the kids are on TikTok.
Yep.
American Airlines giving you 30 free fucking minutes, so we got to get on there. So yeah, we y'all just got an inside view, inside baseball.
Yeah, super inside baseball.
Like a little meeting. But yeah, we expect more bite-sized content.
Yeah.
As we're trying to shift from touring and ticket sales and things like that to, hey, we're like a media network.
Yeah, and somebody made a really good point, and I actually watched this video today, and it stuck in my head that, and this can go to anybody that's making content creation right now. So for you, for instance, if you don't have, especially with a newborn, have the time to necessarily create new content every day, let's just say that you are focused on making your one post a day during whatever the prime time is for TikTok or Instagram, for both of them, let's say. And let's say it's 1 o'clock in the afternoon, and you've got that one piece of content done, you know, it's edited, it's ready to post, and you post it, and then you're done for the day, because that's all that you really have time to do, right? Well, then on a good day, from what I've read, your audience, you have about 15% of your audience is going to see your stuff. 15% of your whole audience on a really good day is going to see your post. On a good day. Mm-hmm. On average, it's about 5% of your audience, as you're seeing right now, for most of your stuff. So if you can make the time to then post one piece of old content that you posted weeks or months ago, you just doubled your odds of having more of your audience see it, because it's not necessarily the same 10 or 15% that's going to see it. So they might. But if they're a fan, they're going to know that, like, oh, that's good, and I want to see it again anyway. But more than likely, another 10% of people that didn't see it the first time are going to see that old post. So in a 365-day calendar, you just doubled your output per day by just posting an old piece of content.
Okay. Some of that math I didn't really compute.
Okay.
But basically, I think you're saying is, like, you can get more bang for your buck by rehashing
and saving time as well, because then you don't have to create that second piece of content.
You already created it. It's just about chopping it down so that people can actually see it.
Chopping it down and then just reposting it, because in a day you instead of posting one post to 15, let's just say 10% of people, you're gonna post two posts that both get 10% odds of audiences seeing it, and you did half of the work because that other piece of content was already made.
Interesting.
Yeah. So, and it's all shit we're just trying to play with, because it changes all the time. You know, it's all these little nuances that these companies, like, say, like TikTok, you got to make sure that the music is in your reels. Like, the music in their top viral, like when you go to sound, you know, and it says like top TikTok or top or whatever,
put
TikTok
it in
viral,
in the background.
It's got to be in the background, man, because they want to promote those songs. So the more that's in there, the higher that your view count will go.
And when you're 42, you know, I'm turning 42 in a couple of weeks.
It's a lot.
It's like you're up against the algorithm. You're up against, you know, it's shit saturated.
Yeah.
and you're trying to keep up. So, but it's an important fight because, like Rob just said, man, everything that's going on, you can view it through the lens of, if it ain't political, it's about to be, because it's culture war.
Right.
So when you might be thinking you're just watching an international sporting event, like, oh, this is just the Olympics and this is what we do, you know? You know, I'm 42, so I remember Mary Lou Retton being on the Wheaties box, you know, the gymnast. I remember what the Olympics are, what, every 4 years or what have you? So I just remember those moments, and I never thought it would get to the point where it's like culture war. It's like, oh, these people are kneeling, and why is it such a big deal that this young lady from Katy, the wrestler, says, oh my God, I love my country, and I want to get thanks to God, and this and that. And it's like, how is that so groundbreaking, refreshing, and rare? Like, you would think that wouldn't be so rare these days to be like, oh, and I actually love the flag and the country I'm representing that I'm actually competing on behalf of. How the hell is that? Like, how do we get to this point? Culture war.
Yeah.
Culture war.
Pretty
all
much.
All culture. Why do you think they want to tear down statues? Why do you think they want to, like, tear everything down so that they can be in charge and in control with their Green New Deal and rule over the ashes? You know?
Did you see her? You saw her, the Olympic, the wrestler, you saw her speech?
I saw that. Yeah, it went pretty viral. Yeah, where she's just like, I love, you know, thank God, and, you know, my coaches make me do this and that, and I love America. And it's like, whew. And meanwhile, you got all these other people just, you know, being useful idiots.
Yeah.
They think they're doing something good by kneeling on behalf of a Marxist organization who don't really care about black people. BLM really don't care about black people. They don't.
No.
If they did, they'd be doing something about black kids getting shot in drive-bys, or the Afro-Cubans fighting for their freedom, and just all kinds of black people that really need to be represented. You know, if you're a black officer that died in the middle of the riots of summer 2020, you'd be celebrating their life because supposedly all black lives matter.
Yeah.
But no, this Marxist organization only wants to amplify and highlight when it's like at the hands of a white man, at the hands of police, just so that they can say defund the police. And then fast forward, the Democrats are blaming that on the Republicans.
Yeah. Dude. It's like, what? It's no wonder people honestly just tune out from a lot of this stuff.
Oh my God. Boy, y'all think y'all slick.
Yeah.
Man, y'all think y'all slick, Joe. Woo!
Joe be dividing.
I threw that Joe in there because people from Chicago, they call everybody Joe.
Do they?
Yeah. That's like a slang.
Oh.
Yeah. So I threw it in there so people from Chicago could be like, see, he's on the right side of the culture war.
That's what's up.
So Joe B. Dividing says it again. He says he's coming for your guns.
Dude.
Come and take it.
P word.
You know what I'm talking about? Come get these ARs. Bro, before you press play on this clip, speaking of coming for your guns, on one of those Fox Nation episodes, they talked about one of the biggest gun grabs that happened. No.
Or New Zealand?
In America, bro.
Oh.
Katrina. Mm. During Katrina.
Oh, the buyback, right?
No. Check this out. No, bro. Check this out.
School me.
Here we go. All right. So anytime there's a crisis and an emergency, some people want to take advantage of that, right? And exploit that. So when Katrina happened, all hell broke loose. People were dying. I mean, you had like infrastructure crash, cell phone towers didn't work, people were looting. I mean, it was chaos. So I guess it was the local government took it upon themselves to go into homes with, what was it, police and sheriffs and things, and basically confiscated weapons. They tackled a little old lady who had a pistol. People needed their guns. They were trying to defend their homes. You had a community, I believe it was in the French Quarter, who basically the neighbors got together and said, hey man, we got guns, you got guns, let's just be a lookout and let's just try to protect each other and be safe. Well, the media spun it as white elitist, militia, something or other, racist. They tried to turn it into a race thing. And anyway, my mind was blown that in America, when you had the Second Amendment, how did they subvert and bypass the Constitution? Like, how did they go around that Second Amendment and go up in people's houses and take their guns just because, oh, well, you know, it's flooding and shit?
That's wild.
It's super wild. If you go on Fox Nation, you could watch that.
So since we're on the subject, I'll play the Joe B. Biden clip here in a second. But this reminded me, I'm sure you know the stat. If not, you know, let's just chat about it real quick. This is what I thought you were referring to.
Mm-mm.
And this is how Vox, you know, reports it. Very, very left-leaning. But Australia confiscates 650,000 guns. And they say, you know, murders and suicides go down. This is from, I think, 17 or 18. But think about what's going on in Australia right now. I mean, they've got chopper. They have the full-fledged military force keeping people indoors.
Right now, I think it's only a couple hundred troops, but they're going to ramp it up. And here's another thing to contextualize what Australia is going through. All right? China has had its tentacles all up in Australia. They really control a lot of Australia. They punish Australia all the time via trade. Like any little thing Australia does that China don't like, they'll be like, well, guess what? We're cutting y'all off. We don't want none of y'all's coffee or none of y'all's whatever they have, whatever
commodities.
Yeah, commodity that they trade. So that's a big factor as well. That's a recipe for destruction. If you got China all up in your mix, already controlling certain factors of your government and your society, and you take away the weapons, and you got a little pandemic going on, somebody's gonna fucking try to take some power.
Straight up, all the power, all the power. But here's a clip from your boy Joseph Breezy,
Joe B. Divide.
I'm gonna continue to fight this for more common sense gun laws, and we're gonna continue to call on Congress to take action, which they've been reluctant to do. That includes a ban on assault weapons and high-capacity magazines like the one used in El Paso. The ID anybody needs for a pistol and or a rifle.
Notice he
anyone
said pistol.
Needs 10, 12, 20, 30, 100 rounds in a rifle. It just makes no sense at
bitch.
All. Zero.
Fuck
doesn't
you,
violate
man.
Anybody's Second Amendment rights to say you can't do that. But it just has to stop. And it includes using my existing authority, which I have, from reining in ghost guns and investing in community policing and community violence intervention.
Nah, cuz.
Somebody needs to juice him up with whatever they've been juicing him up for the last 2 years, because he looks like he's about to fall asleep on that chair.
You know what's funny, man, is I think I had to go run an errand, or I went to do something, but Marisol was in the hospital bed, and she had CNN on because she was just trying
to see. Pain. She loves pain.
Yeah, she loves pain. And I guess a black nurse walked in, and she had CNN on, and Joseph Raheem Breezy was on TV, and she was like, I'm trying to remember all the little things she said,
because
Marisol told me. And one of the things she said was, what they give him today? He looked real alert today.
Yeah.
It's like she was trying to red pill Marisol.
Hell yeah.
And she said what else did she say? She said that she wasn't trying to get the jab, but they like forced her basically, because she's like, well, I do have these other conditions, and you know, they kind of like twisted my arm.
Yeah.
And but she sounded pretty red pill. But before we just move on from that was very, very important. It should be very alarming, you know, if you're China, or if you're a power hungry American government, even without a foreign entity involved, right? It should be very alarming that they just want to trample on that Second Amendment. It's like, sir, mind your business. Like your little rhetoric talking about, oh man, there's no reason. If you notice, they're using those key little words like assault weapon. What the fuck does that mean? Assault weapon.
Exactly.
What does that mean? You trying to say that there's certain rifles I can't have? That's what you're trying to say. You know what I mean? Like, there was another clip where he said, what you need all that for? You trying to buck up to the government? You're going to need tanks and jets for that.
Yeah,
we got nukes
or whatever it was. Yeah. Like, who the fuck? I bet everybody in his cabinet was like, oh my God, he just said that on live TV.
This motherfucker said, bitch, we got nukes. You trying to nuke us?
We didn't give him enough of the shit that makes him clear-headed today.
Obama didn't whisper in your ear, tell you what to say. The teleprompter didn't help you out.
Get him off the stage. Get him off the stage.
Hey,
but Roger that.
But hey, most votes in history, cleanest, fairest election ever. And there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. They just try to like bamboozle you. Thanks a lot, George Lopez.
Fuck, dude.
Thanks a lot, George Lopez. Look at what you promoted, bro. Look at what you doing over there, Eva Longoria, John Leguizamo. Man, y'all some useful idiots, bro. Like, just come out and say you a Marxist, bro. Come out and say it. I don't give a damn. I'm not trying to tour comedically my whole life anyway. I know Hollywood ain't gonna accept me anyway. They don't want some real talent over there.
You got the best actor award though.
I am nominated for best drama performance in a short film. Know what I'm talking about? But just come out and say it, right? Admit you were wrong. Admit. I mean, shit, bro, you ain't got no guns? Like, what the fuck? And Beto O'Rourke too, man. I can't believe I took a picture with that man. I can't believe I went on stage with that man.
Talking about I'm a feminist.
Yeah, I said I'm a feminist on stage.
Chingo was spitting bars, you know, with him on stage, rapping at his concert or whatever it was.
Like, everybody, ho, 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 hey.
Nombre.
When I say CC, y'all say P.
CCP. That's so dumb. Yeah, man. I know. But luckily, we're in the United States, and we can actually talk about this. We can shine light on it. We can we can poke fun at it still. We can...
Thankfully.
So.
Thankfully, we don't have to speak in code.
Well, kind of. People are getting real clever with their code, too.
What the fuck's going on with my fucking Ring cameras?
Oh, man.
Marisol texts me talking about who's here, and I'm trying to check my camera. Somebody's ringing the doorbell, she said.
You want to go run up there?
Fuck, bro. We still got a little bit more time to go.
Well, we're at exactly an hour, so.
Okay.
Wrap it up, and we'll pick up tomorrow.
Yeah, because I got to go get my AR real quick.
Do it.
Yo, thank you guys so much for listening. I need some of that juice they're giving Joe Biden because, man, I'm very sleepy today. My wife is MVP. She went through a lot to deliver our little baby. Very blessed, very grateful for you guys as well. All the congrats that you guys sent me, all
love
the
support everywhere,
real talk, all the patrons really feel it. My concerts are going to be like baby showers. Right now we need newborn Pampers, and then I'll let y'all know when she moves up to little swaddlers and then little crawlers and then little toddlers. But yo, thank you guys so much. Keep your head on a swivel, don't fall for the okie doke. Look out for the culture war. Don't let these celebrities walk you off a cliff. You know, really start to look at things through that lens. You know, participate, speak up the same way Elizabeth Warren told people to speak up on behalf of abortion. Speak up on behalf of freedom, man, on behalf of liberties, on behalf of the Constitution. Stop letting people trash our country, talk down on our flag. You know what I mean? Anyway, you guys are the bomb. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. I'll see you guys real soon, but keep it locked right here. More episodes coming. Thank you.
Yes.